Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Horticulturally Yours. My name's Dr. Barry Palmer. I'm the producer and host, and I'd like to welcome you to our show this evening. And as you can tell by what's going on here in front of me, it's going to be a little bit of a holiday show, Horticultural Holidays, and we're going to have a special presentation about a taste of Williamsburg. And sitting next to me is our one guest, straight in from Williamsburg, Ms. Grace Klein. Grace is the president, a retread president, I think. You've been president how many times before, Grace?
About five times,
Of the Laureldale Garden Club, very, very active organization. And Grace, it's a pleasure to have you on the show.
Thank you.
And sitting next to Grace is Dieter Walter. Dieter has been on this show probably 10, 15 times.
Dieter's
going to talk about some holiday foliage and some holiday plants, house plants. Do's and don'ts of house plants for the holiday season. So, Grace, are you ready to take us to Williamsburg?
Oh, yes, I am. Okay. It has been a delight again to revisit Williamsburg. I attended their 65th Garden Symposium in April, and it was just wonderful. Everything, of course, was way ahead of what we had here, so the tulips were blooming, and the daffodils were blooming, and the things were popping up out of the gardens, and it was really, really a nice treat. So this was the booklet that I had gotten. Now, I've been to Williamsburg several times, and I must say that I was there a few years ago to attend the Grand Illumination. Now, if you get chance, that is a wonderful thing to do. At 5:30, what they do at Christmas time is they fire their cannons and their muskets, and that is the start of all the people in the Williamsburg area light their candles in the windows. And then the fife and drum comes marching down the main street. And then at 6:30, they have the grandest, oh my goodness, fireworks. And so that was really good. But that was a couple years ago. So this was an altogether different trip I took this year. But every time I go back, it's exciting because there's always something new to do. And you get to even partake in some of the skits and things that they have that you're actually part of it. I know one time we went there and I had to take the part. I was being tried.
Is that in the governor's mansion?
Yes.
I've done that.
Oh, yes. And that was great. And then one night we went to the spooky. He was telling a story. And it was just so great. I mean, there's no electric and everything is just wonderful there. But so I thought today what I would do is show you a few of the Williamsburg types of designs that they used. And if you were to go down now, you would probably see something like this hanging from a lot of the shops. This is a kissing ball, what they call. And you can add other greens and things to it, and you can make it more festive. But let me take it off of here.
Now, is this really colonial, or was this...
This is colonial.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. And like I said, you can add a little mistletoe on the bottom. And these are done. What I started with was a styrofoam ball. There's many sizes. And I think the one I started with was about that big round. And then I added the boxwood. And what I did was I took a toothpick and inserted it into the styrofoam, and then I added my fresh greens. These are very nice. You can hang them above a doorway, but these also look very nice hanging in a window. If you have something that you just don't want to spend a lot on, a lot of wreaths and so forth, something like this, and if you do have boxwood, use it up. And if you don't, and you like to do all kinds of crafts, be sure that you get yourself a boxwood tree, because they're wonderful. You can keep snipping and snipping, and it's never ending. And I do use it year-round for many things.
And if you take your snippets in the spring, I push them down in the soil.
Oh, yes.
They germinate, or not germinate, but they root very easily.
I have 7 in the front of my house that were given to me. Mm-hmm. Those were the first ones I had gotten. Mm-hmm. And so they're right in
put
the front
there. Put a
little
root tone on them and just stick them in the dirt.
Well, you know what?
Soil.
The woman,
woman
that gave them to me, she didn't even stick them in root tone.
She didn't?
No, she started them and then I got them from a friend of mine. Yeah. So this
boxwoods are fine. You can make topiaries. You can
make
dogs and things.
Oh, yes, yes, yes. You can make topiaries if I would have a stick. I've done this. I put a cinnamon stick in here and then maybe made a bigger one. The styrofoam balls come in many different sizes. Mm-hmm. So
very nice.
That's one thing that I thought is very festive and very inexpensive. I had a group, and they hadn't ever done the pomanders. Pomanders are very very scented, and they're very popular. They were popular, and they still are now. It's fun to do if you want a project for your children or just to decorate with.
What is a pomander?
This is a pomander.
Oh, that's what I thought. Is that cloves?
This is cloves.
Okay.
Now, this is an old one. Some of these must be 20 years old.
Wow.
Believe it or not. And
are they aromatic?
Oh, yeah.
Still?
You can still smell the cloves. And
wow.
And if they do lose their scent a little bit, you can always add oils and so forth, mm-hmm. or rub some cinnamon over them and so forth. That is, they use those. Now, you can also make pomanders out of lemons and limes. And these are made out of little... I have one that I did up.
Kumquats?
Kumquats. This is one that I did with kumquats. Very small.
Yeah.
And that's what a kumquat looks like.
They're cute.
Yeah.
You can hang those on your tree.
You can hang them on the tree, yes. Mm-hmm. So, and then I just stuck him in there. I had made him a long time ago, and I stuffed him with cloves.
Now, do they use Christmas trees in Williamsburg? That's not colonial,
oh,
is it?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, you can use colonial trees. Oh, yeah. But most of their things are things that they've taken from the garden because everything that they had to make use out of.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of things, they dried their flowers. If you can see the little gal down here, I have a little miniature drying rack down there.
Oh, yeah. Like a towel rack.
All
yeah.
Yes. Everything they had to save, like I said, everything out of the garden. And... So in the wintertime, it got cool and so forth, and then they could decorate with what they had. They were great for decorating. And this little lantern here, I got this at Williamsburg. And I had some holly, but evidently I forgot some of my supplies at home. So I would put holly in here mm-hmm. to add this. But you could put little kumquats in there mm-hmm. or whatever. But that's a little souvenir I brought back from me.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a typical type of Williamsburg arrangement.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what they call a Williamsburg brick. This is a smaller one so that you can see. They're very easy to decorate with. And
now, are they made out of a clay? Or a ceramic?
No, they're ceramic.
Okay.
They're ceramic. And some are very, very old. And I have a little one, if you can see, they also do something with the five-fingered vases. And there's a miniature one down there, if you can see that one.
Oh.
And I'm going to finish this one off in a few minutes. One of the things when I was going out into my garden, there's one section that's down my one hill, very, 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 very precarious. But it is... the one place where I have several plants coming up out of the wild of the Christmas fern. And I don't know whether you can get this, but it's called the Christmas fern because if you take a leaf, it looks like a little Christmas sock. And that's how it got its name.
A Christmas sock? You mean
yeah.
like
see the little sock?
Oh, yeah.
See the little sock?
I don't know if you can you get that on there.
I don't know if you can or not, but it's still very much alive, and I can always count on it at this time of the year, along with some of these other ferns. Now, some of my other ferns, they're done. But these two are mostly the wild kind that came to me from the heavens. Mm-hmm. And I can count on them every Christmas and Thanksgiving time to use these ferns in different arrangements.
Now, these aren't Christmas ferns, are they?
No, these are my regular ferns.
Yeah.
These are just wild ferns. Yeah. They're up the hill from these. Mm-hmm. But I really had to go halfway down, and it was really, really...
So they're sock-shaped.
Yes, they are. Mm-hmm. They're really cute. But that's why they got their name. I don't know the botanical name for it, but that is why it's called the Christmas. Mm-hmm. Okay, let me put this little pomander back here.
I always learn so much when I come here.
Oh, well, you used to go home and do those now with your little
granddaughter. My granddaughter would love to do that.
She would love it. When you're doing the pomanders, take a toothpick and stick it in and then push your clove in there. And like I said, these must be like 20 years old that I've had. And you can hang them up if you want to, or the little kumquats look cute on a Christmas tree, in fact.
Oh, she'd love the kumquats.
Yeah, they're good to eat, too.
Oh, she likes that stuff.
Here I have some of the other ones that I have made, too. These are just ripening now. I did one in a spiral. And these pods, like I said, they used everything to decorate with. These pods are magnolia pods. Now, there's many kinds of magnolias, and I really don't know which one I had. But I did collect a few to use in different arrangements. But that is
a seed pod.
Yes, and these were laying all over the ground, hundreds and hundreds of them. So, now I was shopping, and I found these little adorable little. They look like flowers, but they're edible.
It's like a piece of an apricot or
something. No, it's a persimmon.
Persimmon, okay.
Yeah, it's a persimmon. But I thought, oh, that would be really cute and very decorative too. And so I got them just to decorate. Okay, one of the other things that they had was they did a lot with cones and stacking, even like glass cake dishes and so forth, tiered, and they would put all kinds of candies and desserts and things like that. This is put on with I put the apples on, and it's what they call a cone, a nailed cone. And I'll show you the back of it. I didn't finish it because I wanted to show it to you. That's what it looks like. And then you stack, you can put oranges, lemons.
So that's a piece of green styrofoam?
No, it's real heavy.
Oh.
It is real heavy. It would not tip over.
Okay.
If you had styrofoam, it wouldn't hold the weight of the apples. Now, I did have something else that I was going to bring, and that was in the box that I forgot.
Tell them about the mystery box, Grace.
The mystery box. Yes, I don't know. I had everything ready, and somehow I got here, and I didn't. But I have to tell you, what I did here is all I did was stick the apples on, and then again I took my boxwood, and I filled in different places. And I had the most beautiful pine cone to put here. And I even cut into this was a faux pineapple, I mean. And
that means false, doesn't it?
Yes, okay. Yes. So instead of buying a great big heavy pineapple to put on this small arrangement, I was going to make a faux pineapple. And it was so neat. It's all glittered. And I just pushed the pine cone on here. And then at the top, I had a house plant that had those spiky leaves. And I cut into that. And it really did the job. But I forgot the pine cone. So anyhow, this is, like I said, you can purchase these cones and so forth. And they have different sizes. And these are a few of the books that I had gotten there through the years, too. This one's called More Christmas Ideas from Williamsburg, Christmas in Williamsburg. And this one I just bought when I was down there in April. This is wonderful. It's called From a Colonial Garden. It's ideas, decorations, recipes, and it's got everything in here. And if you get down there and you like to craft and so forth, look this book up because it's well worthwhile. It has a wealth of information and how-tos in here. Now what I'm going to do next is, I mentioned the five-fingered vase. And this is a five-fingered vase. My daughter thinks they're the ugliest things, but I like them. So I have several different kinds, colors, and so forth. And so what all I did was I started, so I wouldn't take up a whole lot of time. I started and I put some of my ferns that are growing right now. And I'm going to...
Now, is that a colonial design, the five-fingered vase?
Oh, yes. Okay. Oh, yes. Yes, yes. And you can
I
see...
I mean, guys don't know about those
yeah.
things.
No, this is definitely okay. what you consider a colonial okay. and Williamsburg type of vase.
Just want to make sure you're being authentic.
Oh,
here
it is. It is authentic. And like you can see, the little one there... that's a teeny weeny. That's I took that out of my dollhouse to bring in, but I just fell in love with that. I had to have that one. But I have quite a collection of different ones. And for people that don't have Williamsburg types of arrangements and you want to arrange easy, I've often used toothbrush holders with the little holes in top. And you just stick your flowers in there, and that works out fine. I have quite a collection of those, too. Very, very interesting. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to add red carnations. Now, I'm not quite sure. Let's see. I'm going to turn this around so I can see what I'm doing. I'm going to add some red car. I'm going to cut these a little shorter. They're like layered. So... I'm going to add one in each little spot. Carnations are, the mini carnations are very, very inexpensive. And you get so many on a stem if you'd want to do something like this.
Where do they grow carnations?
I don't grow. Well,
mostly right now, everything comes up from South America.
South America?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, we have the mini carnations in the spring and summer, but nothing like this. You really can't grow. Okay. So this is what I have so far. This would be typical. Now, if it'd be in the summertime, I would probably add maybe roses in here or maybe some lavender to give it color. And maybe some status, whatever you would have in your garden. So these here, these are weeds that I picked this summer, and I dried them, and I just sprayed them gold.
Just regular roadside weeds?
Yeah, they were growing in my yard, though. But I thought they were pretty. They have a name. I sort of think... I'm not sure if they're a rose campion, maybe. I did know, but I don't know anymore. But I'm going to add these in. And I sprayed them with gold. And I just used a gold metallic paint. Just a regular, any kind of metallic paint. You could do silver. Or the gold. You'd be surprised what you find in your garden. The birds bring you lots of presents.
Well, I guess the more of this you do, the more observant you become, don't you?
Oh, yes. I cut off the pods from the last year. I think I brought pods in from my iris. They're really neat to paint.
Oh, yeah.
And
they look like swollen thumbs.
Yeah.
Is that the ones you made?
Yes, okay. Yes. You can use. There's a lot of things that you just have to really think about. Oh, I'm going to try that.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes it works, but you're really not losing anything by doing it.
There are no rules here.
No rules. And this is just doesn't want to stay up. But let's borrow some of this. So that gives you an idea.
Ooh.
But the thing is to layer, you know, and like I say, if you had tall, spiky things, I would probably add some more in here. But like I say, in the summertime, you have a lot of things, like the lavender and the blue salvia. Oh, I love to use that with the baby roses in here. The baby pink fairy roses are really, really nice. And they have all sizes of these finger vases, you know, from real big to real small. But whenever I see them, I try to collect them.
Where do you get something like that?
The finger vase?
Yeah. Go to what, AC Moore?
Well, no, I don't think AC Moore would have them. I probably got this in Williamsburg.
Oh,
and
okay.
I know they came from Williamsburg. But a lot of times you go on eBay and you look for a five-finger vase. And I've gotten some through there that I really liked. So, okay. One other thing is the things that you get from the garden, they also like to have their tea, of course. And I have a Rosa rugosa rose, and these are the little pods. After the flower falls away, you have these little pips.
Now, they're Rosa rugosa, that's the wild rose, isn't it?
No, it's an old rose.
It's just an old rose?
Yes, okay. And a friend of mine, mine is a red one, and a friend of mine last Thursday, she brought me a white one up. So I didn't even get it in the ground yet. But these are the little, after the flowers fall away, these little pips start, and they swell, and they swell, and they swell. So you can bring these in and then dry them, and you can make yourself a wonderful cup of rose hip tea, which they did in Williamsburg. And or you could reseed them and start them mm-hmm. another rose plant and so forth.
And they're supposed to be very, very high in vitamins?
Vitamin C. It really is loaded with vitamin C.
Yeah.
So, of course, they didn't have drugstores back in colonial days. So everything, like I said, coming from the garden was they had to save, and mm-hmm. whether it be horehound to make the horehound cough drops, just so many things that came. But they really, really cleaned mm-hmm. their gardens well with everything that they raised. And that was the main thing for the William, all colonists, the wives, to do, is to prepare for the garden. Mm-hmm. That was their main job. And the men, of course, had to, you know, do the building and so forth. Mm-hmm. But that was the woman's job, and to take everything, even the twigs that were left over, to use in the fireplaces mm-hmm. and so forth. But anyway, I guess that's about what I have. Dieter, I'm going to turn it over to you now.
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy.
Thank you, Grace.
Oh, you're quite welcome.
Before Dieter goes, I want to let you know that Dieter is the owner of Temple Greenhouse, and he provides plants and decorations and things for every season up there.
Up in
Temple, up on, what, 8th Street? Oh, it's time for a break.
Avenue.
Time for a break.
Okay.
Excuse me, Dieter. Okay, BCTV.
You're watching Horticulturally Yours on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other information about gardening, go to bctv.org.
All right, Dieter, you're on.
I'm on. Well, it's the season. the season for decorating, the season for plants, the season for all the myths that surround the plants, and the questions that we get constantly. Somebody calls up and says, are the poinsettias going to be harmful for my cat or dog or something? And the answer is no. They did a lot of trials with the poinsettias, and what they did is they really force-feed rats with the leaves of the poinsettias and to see if they're going to get an upset stomach. Like I always say, if somebody is worried about whether the cat is going to breathe his last farewell after he eats a poinsettia, no, it's not. The animal has to eat almost a whole half a greenhouse full of plants in order to get an upset stomach. I would even get an upset stomach if I had to eat a half a greenhouse full of plants. But it's definitely erroneous. And I always cringe when some of the TV shows say, oh yes, poinsettias, they are poisonous. They are definitely not. Now, it's totally different. Like Gracie said, she forgot the holly. The holly berries are definitely poisonous. And there you got really have to watch that your pets and your little children don't eat the berries. And the other one that I refuse to have in my greenhouse, and you see them all over the stores, is the Jerusalem cherry. The Jerusalem cherry is very, very poisonous. And I have grandchildren running through the greenhouses every day, and I cannot afford, and I don't want to be any part of it, having Jerusalem cherries there, and they pick the berries because they look like little cherries. And it's an absolute no. That is
now,
very
with
difficult.
With the holly berries, do birds eat them?
Oh, yeah.
And they're not, they don't bother them at all?
No, no. It's, you know, but the holly berries is definitely, the mistletoe is another one that is quite poisonous. Mistletoe this year, we tried to always have fresh mistletoe on hand for the customers, and this year it's an absolute no. They had with as much rain as they had down south, just like here, it had a crop failure, so there's no very, very hard to get fresh mistletoe.
I have a question for
you. Yes, yes.
This is a berry, but it's not a holly berry.
Yes.
Blueberries.
Blueberries.
Is there?
I like them on pancakes.
Oh, I love them. Tell me, do they have to have, is there a brand that does not need a mate?
Most of the places will tell you there are, and but I find that it takes two different varieties to get a better production.
Okay, because I bought one.
Yeah, one. I know. I fell into the same trap. I said to one of the suppliers, I says, I need some blueberry plants to sell. Mm-hmm. And he says, oh, yeah, this one is self-pollinating. You don't need anything else. Yep, right. They do pollinate much better if there's two.
Okay. Then you have
two different varieties.
Two that are going to pollinate roughly at the same time. Too,
right,
don't you?
Yeah. But it's definitely,
You can't get an early season and a late season.
No, but that's why we usually sell like three or four different varieties to make sure that you have at least two different ones. Mm-hmm. And that you get a much better production out of it. Mm-hmm. Even my son planted some blueberries, and we had all one variety, and I says, well, you should have planted some others. And he says, well, now you tell me. So we do the same thing. Now, poinsettias, naturally this is the time of year, the commercial growers, they grow everything in a soilless mix. Now, our soil still has a little bit of soil in it. But the soilless mix is good, and it's a problem. People that like to water them quickly, you put the water in, it runs through, and they think they did a fantastic job and watered the plants and actually just ran through and never absorbed anything. If the plant gets too dry, then the water runs right through the mixture. Now, and like in ours, what I always tell them is, if the plant gets really dry, take the whole pot, submerge it. Wait 2 minutes, take it out, and let it drain. People love putting foil on the poinsettias. I do it all the time. If you leave the foil on, make sure you put a hole in it so it drains. If the poinsettia sits in water, it only takes 2 days, and the roots rot, and you lost your plant. The leaves will turn yellow, they fall off, and you have a lovely, crappy plant looking. Mm-hmm. So you got to watch it. If you have saucers, fine. When you water them, make sure that it gets into the saucer, but then empty the saucers. Do not let them sit in the saucer with water. That's the most people that kill the poinsettias, the quickest way of getting repeat sales. So, yes.
No wet feet, right?
No wet feet.
Now, I was told, I don't remember who told me, that if you just put one or two ice cubes in,
yeah,
top, then it just sort of, you know, drinks that slowly.
Well, it would, yeah.
But that's a good thing?
Yeah, I'd rather have it with bourbon.
Oh.
Yeah, no, it's, you can do that, but you got to watch that you don't put too many in, because then it gets too cold. And if the root system gets too cold, then it's no good.
Like, I do that with my house plants, too.
Right.
I put maybe two or three ice cubes in it, throw them in.
Yeah.
And let it, so that doesn't run right out the bottom.
Right. You can do that.
Yeah.
Just save it for the bourbon. Now, the other thing is that, like, we grow 21 different varieties of poinsettias. We have 5 different reds. Well, why do we grow 5 reds? One variety is a shorter variety, the other one's a little taller. This one is the crinkly leafed one, then there's different shades. Each one has its own characteristic, and you can get specific varieties of poinsettias to fit every niche that you want to come to it. And we have this year was a very good year and a very difficult year for poinsettia growers. Mainly, what we do is everything is timed as far as making sure that the flower and the size of the plant all comes together at the right time. If you remember that far back in the in the middle of September, we had these long cloudy days and warm, and beginning in October, it was always warm and stuff. That when the commercial grower tries to slow down the poinsettia, we put a growth retardant on, and we have until the 5th of October. And after that, if it gets too warm, the growth retardant pretty nearly doesn't do its job. In other words, if it's too warm, the plant will just keep on growing. So this year, the varieties that we wanted to have a little taller got a little taller, and the ones that stayed nice and short, like this one here, this Ice Crystal, stayed really nice and compact. It's a gorgeous color. But that is the variety, the nature of the beast. We have another one that is variegated, and it's pretty nearly this tall. So each variety has its own characteristics, and you have to see which ones you want.
Dieter, how long have poinsettias been under cultivation?
That's a good question.
Did they find them in Mexico?
Yeah, it's actually that's where it got its name. The ambassador from the U.S. to Mexico was named Poinsett.
Oh.
And in his honor, he found the poinsettia in Mexico and brought it back. And in his honor, the poinsettia was named Poinsettia. So, yes, you're correct.
150 years, maybe?
Somewhere in there.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, the new varieties are just so much easier to grow. I remember when we first came there used to be two varieties of poinsettias to grow. And it wasn't difficult to have 3-foot poinsettias. They actually went through all lengths. They made them dry. They bend them over and to keep them shorter. It was really terrible. Now, with the new cultivars, there's three main breeders that breed poinsettias all the time. And if you, like I said, we grow 21 varieties. If you ever go to Delaware Valley, when they have their poinsettia trials, they have like 150 different varieties, and that's just scratching the surface. If you ever get to California and go to Equis, see all their trials and the new varieties that are coming out, it's always fascinating as to what the plant breeder actually can do. And how long it takes to really get the desired results. Like we have a couple jingle bells that have one flower is totally white where the others are all speckled.
Wow.
Well, then they take that one cutting and then they see if it is true, and then they grow it again next year. And that's how they get the new varieties. They get the pink ones and the burgundies and all the other different varieties.
When you see poinsettias that are like purple and really turquoise, are they dyed?
Yes.
Okay.
There's actually a dye out that, and a couple of years ago they were very popular.
Yes, yes.
And my daughter is very... anal is not the right word. Peculiar, very particular.
Yes, that's
yes,
a better
very,
word.
Better word than anal. But she actually covers all the other leaves. And then she has, she puts it on with a brush. And then in order to get the stripe in it, then she has to go with alcohol over it and take some of the paint off. And
wow.
it's a long process.
I thought that was something that came from
no.
the bottom and up from
no.
the roots and out.
No, it comes from the top.
I never knew that.
Yeah, it's not like a dying carnation that turned
right.
green. No,
right.
no. And, you know, we used to do that. We had the one church... wanted all green poinsettias, so she had to make all green poinsettias.
Wow.
It was very nice to look at, but you know, at first you think, "Wow, that was a little goofy," but it looked really sharp when they were done.
Mm-hmm.
So now this variety here, which is the winter rose variety, this is a crinkly leafed, almost like a chrysanthemum. The leaves, as you can see, turn over. The flower is more compact. That particular variety took Eki about 18 years to perfect. So it was it took that long for the breeders to actually breed exactly what is
yeah.
in the plant.
That looks like velvet. Their leaves actually.
Yeah,
like
they're
velvet.
Really gorgeous. Now we have some. Whites and pinks and well, they have all different colors, but this one actually was really popular about 4 years ago or 5 years ago, and now it shrank a little bit, but I like it, so we have some, and we always sell out of them, so it's a very interesting phenomenon. Okay, Let's see, let's see what my notes say here. Okay. Also this year, for the grower, the on poinsettias especially, some of the chemicals, like I mentioned that already, didn't take because of the heat. So this year it cost a lot more to keep the bugs away, because the bugs, with all this heat and moisture, just kept multiplying, and so we had to spray a lot more this year than other years. Okay, now that's enough on poinsettias. Any questions? No?
No.
No, okay. Cyclamens. This is a miniature cyclamen. It is a very lovely holiday plant, and people have problems with it because it will tell you exactly when it needs water. In other words, all of a sudden you come in and the whole flowers lay all over the place. Well, it needs water. This one, again, is like a bulb. Everything comes from the center, and you can't see it, but it shoots up the little buds all the time. If you water around the outside. You do not water on the center, because if it stays wet too long in the center, all of a sudden it will rot and will die.
Now, do they bloom only in the winter? Or?
It is actually a better winter plant, mainly because it likes it cool. Mm-hmm. This is the traditional European flower. Mm-hmm. With rooms that were in the 40s and 50 degree, that is actually what this particular plant loves. It likes a cool room. It loves it. When we grow them in a greenhouse, you cannot grow them with poinsettias. They have to have a lot of air, a lot of cool. It's a totally different ball game.
And they come in a lot of different shades.
A lot of different shades.
White.
Yeah.
Pink.
Now, before we got all the different flowers in from South America or Holland or the cut flowers, when my dad was growing cyclamens in Germany, it was mainly for cut flowers. Actually, it's fairly simple. You used to have quite large cyclamens, and you just pull the flower off. It gets a little crook, and you cut it, but then you have to split the stem in order for it to absorb water. If you just stick it in water like this, it's not going to absorb the water. But once you split the stem, it will absorb the water. And at one time, my dad always used to say that he made more money on the flowers than on the plants, because he used to grow them, just the flowers, and send them to the market, and they used to use them as...
Would they root that?
No.
No.
Okay.
But are they fairly long-lasting then? After
almost 2 weeks.
Oh, really? Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
Very nice, you know, which is always surprising. But now with the warmer houses, and the availability of... all the different plants, I don't think it's not used anymore as a cut flower. It's strictly used as a potted plant. Okay. Christmas cactus. Okay.
Mine's
Mr. Walter, how come my Christmas cactus isn't blooming? What do I do wrong? Is it still living? Yes, it's still living. I did absolutely everything right. Why isn't it blooming? Okay, mainly what happens is it will set flower by stress. Stress can come in two or three different ways. Either too dry, or you let it very run dry, the leaves will almost turn reddish. And then all of a sudden you start watering it and everyone pops out of flower. Too cold. This is actually how the commercial grower will time the Christmas cactus to flower at this time. We run them warm to grow them, and then all of a sudden we drop like 15 degrees the temperature at night, like for a week or two, and then you can put it back up to warm, and every one of the ends will have a bud in a couple weeks. It is a trigger that most plants, if they are put under stress, will get the reproductive cycle going. And the flower is actually the reproductive cycle. So therefore, it will make seeds and it will continue the species. So almost all the plants, when they are under stress a little bit more, will bloom better and will flourish better. Now, when we get to African violets, whatever I said, don't believe it. It doesn't hold true. And on the poinsettias, the new varieties, you cannot put them under stress, then you lose leaves. So, but actually, most of the plants will send up flowers because of stress.
Now, there are different kinds of cactus. I've heard like Thanksgiving cactus, Easter cactus,
yeah.
And some of the leaves are shaped differently.
Yeah, the Easter cactus, well, this one here looks like a shrimp when it opens up.
Yes.
The Easter cactus actually looks like a little tulip or almost like a crocus.
Uh-huh.
When you look, picture the flower like that, and it's like a little bell-shaped and has the stamens and pistils out, and it's really totally different.
And do they come in colors then, the Easter, or are they all
Yeah,
white?
It's mostly in the reds.
Oh, really?
Mostly reds. I've seen some orange, and I've seen some of the others, but mostly reds.
Okay.
But the leaves are a little different. They're more oval-shaped. And they have a little more hairy at the end, but it's a different. This is a cygus cactus, so.
Yeah. I was thinking they reminded me of like a claw, more or less.
Yeah.
The Easter.
And they live almost forever, don't they?
Yeah, you can. Provided you do not overwater them. If you overwater them, the roots will rot again. Cactus, if you mix your own soil, get a potting soil, take a brick, break the brick up, red brick into small pieces, put it in the soil, one third of it, at least that brick, a little bit of sand. That way it is a very porous soil so that the roots do not rot.
Oh. Peter,
yes.
We have a home viewer.
Wow. Yes.
Yes, I don't mean to change the subject, but is coal ash good to be put on the garden soil right now?
Well, if you do it now, it has a lot of time to dissipate. If you put it on too strong in the spring when it's too... It depends... what kind of coal you're using. It depends how well you burned them. It's like a charcoal thing that works great on a lot of this to sweeten the soil.
I burn the nut coal and it goes to a pure white powder. I was just wondering if I've heard already it's good for the garden, and can you overdo it?
Oh, you can overdo it, definitely, yes. Yeah, I would put it on now, let the rain do its thing, and let it filter into the soil a little better. I would not go really in the spring, no.
Okay, what's the advantages? It's
potash.
But it's potash. It's,
okay.
It's like a fertilizer, that any good fertilizer will have potash in it, and you get that from the burning the coal, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, home viewer.
African violets. We used to grow hundreds of different varieties, but the new ones that are commercially grown are mostly the Rhapsodies and some of the others. that really are very good for timing, for commercial timing. In other words, when a whole greenhouse is timed to bloom all at the same time so that the grower can ship them out. The home grower naturally will put water on them from the bottom. They water them from the bottom. There's actually special pots for African violets that have a saucer on the bottom, and that's how it gets its nutrients. I prefer watering off the top, but if you do, please do it with lukewarm water, and or that the water that you're putting on the leaves is within 10 degrees plus or minus the temperature of the leaves. Otherwise, you will get spotted leaves.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All the plants you have there, that's the most tropical, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely. Okay. Absolutely. Poinsettias, too, yeah. And the other one is the Colanche, almost like a succulent, very thick leaf, doesn't need much water except when it's flowering. And it's the same thing with the Christmas cactus. What you do is, people ask me, how often do we water the Christmas cactus? If you don't have flowers on a dry side, once you have the buds initiated, then you got to treat it more like a blooming plant. You have to water it more. If you don't, then all of a sudden all the buds will fall off and you defeated the purpose if you run them too dry then. So it's a little more tricky. Dry to make them flower. My wife is great on these Christmas cactus. She has them blooming 3 times a year, but she ignores the darn things. So under stress is always very important. Okay, now this time of the year we do have at the greenhouse a lot of decorations. I could have brought all the different greens in like we did the last time. And we do have a lot of the Willy's goodies, the German food items that we have. So come on out.
We have an invitation?
Absolutely. I even gave you some Christmas.
I know. Give me some stolen.
Some stolen, yes. It's a German cake bread type, and it's very good, especially for the holidays.
It was very good.
Yes, this very is the good. One I brought was with marzipan.
What's the best time to visit your greenhouse for the
right
see
now?
The holiday.
We're open 7 days a week.
Okay.
Unfortunately, we don't have any time off right
okay.
now. So 9 to 5. Another week or so, we'll start Wednesdays through Fridays and longer hours.
Very good.
But right now, it's 7 days a week.
Very
the plants
good.
Don't take vacation, so I can't either.
No, agribusiness is a tough one, isn't
yes,
it?
Yes, indeed.
Yeah.
And this year, it's been challenging because of all the moisture, all the heat at the wrong time, and this cold snap. We never lost a whole week trying to clean up trees and bushes and stuff, and this year, unfortunately, a lot of people are going to be looking for bushes in the spring because Mother Nature did you cruel.
Yeah, my woods just have huge branches laying down everywhere.
And mine.
Yeah, my brother had a really giant oak tree, and that sucker fell over
right
the
over.
Road.
And yeah.
Well, I keep thinking this is nature's way of pruning.
Yeah.
Yes.
So the only thing is,
did a great job this year. So
I'll be a whole year cleaning up my.
Well, we have 2 minutes left. What do you know to share?
What do I know?
In 1 minute.
Okay. All I can say is, enjoy your garden, and really experiment. I mean, these little things here, those were anemone pods. And I try different things, and I dry them. So be experimental.
You know what I find?
What?
Now, I'm not going to go to the store and buy anything.
No.
What can I use? It's right here in the garden.
Right here.
Or in the garage or around
right.
the house.
You have coxcomb here. You have yarrow, which was a big yarrow, and I put it into little pieces, and I you know, wired
very
it up
pretty.
And use little ones. But try different things from your garden. The pods from the iris. There's just so many things. Hosta leaves make beautiful arrangements. And just experiment. And it's a lot of fun.
Dieter, you have a minute now.
And do enjoy the family.
Oh, yes.
Do enjoy the grandchildren. You know, Christmas without family, it's just not Christmas.
Well, and I think we're going to get little Gracie making, what do you call them, palm?
Absolutely.
Palmanders.
Palmanders.
And you want her to make a little kissing bowl.
Yes.
Also.
My granddaughters are going to have to make their wreath. Every year they have to make at least one wreath. We use three times as much greens and everything else, but they have to make one wreath.
Well, and this is a very simple wreath if we have time.
Yeah.
On a straw base, all I did was tuck in the little boxwood.
Of boxwood.
And that your granddaughter could easily do.
Yes, she would love
Lots
that.
Of fun.
Love it. Okay, well, thank you both. Now, I want to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, both Grace and Dieter said that they could back on the show in the heat of June and July, and we're going to talk about fairy and pixie gardens and how to make fairy and pixie gardens and make little houses for them out underneath, you know, where the rabbits play in the bracken. Well, that's where the fairies live too. So look for that show in the heat. Anyway, I hope you all have a very nice holiday season. Thank you for being with us, and good night.